Good afternoon. Let me warmly welcome all of you for our monthly clinical meeting organized by the Sri Lanka Medical Association in collaboration with the professional colleges. In this time, it is with the Sri Lanka College of Psychiatrists. I'm very thankful to President and the Council of the Sri Lanka College of Psychiatrists for agreeing to collaborate with the Sri Lanka Medical Association in organizing this clinical meeting. And there will be a presentation on delirium, review of a neuropsychiatric syndrome by the team led by Dr. K.P. Manisha Dalpatadu and her senior registrar and registrar in psychiatry. So to commence the proceedings of the webinar, let me warmly invite Dr. A. Tashreek Faus to commence his presentation. Dr. Faus, over to you.
Thank you very much, dear madam, and a very good afternoon to all. First and foremost, I would like to thank the Sri Lanka Medical Association for giving us this opportunity to discuss an important topic, delirium, review of a neuropsychiatric syndrome. So our patient is a 69-year-old married gentleman who is self-employed and hailing from Pamankada, Vallavatta. He was brought by his family members with the complaints of hearing of voices and muttering to self, along with low mood and suicidal ideations and refusal of meals for the last 2 months' duration, which had worsened over the last 2 weeks. Mr. D is a diagnosed patient with mental illness for the last 15 years, but with an erratic follow-up and poor adherence to medication. He had been functioning apparently well up until 2 months ago, running his own business. He had faced some financial difficulties and losses of his newly invested business due to the COVID pandemic, along with resultant sleep deprivation and increased irritability. He had also had concerns and had been preoccupied regarding his business and future. This has also been associated with low mood, loss of appetite, and poor sleep with early morning awakening. He had experienced frequent suicidal ideas due to a commanding type of auditory hallucination and belief that thoughts are being inserted into his mind by unknown forces. Mr. D also had a family history of mental illness, with two of his elder sisters being affected. He had been on treatment for more than 15 years, and he had been on antidepressants plus antipsychotics, but had an erratic follow-up, and there had been no prior history of being given ECT. If I were to discuss his mental state examination on admission, Mr. D was an elderly male who looked his stated age, or older than his stated age, and he was dressed appropriately and maintained an adequate level of self-care. He had poor eye contact during the interview and seemed to be responding to some form of internal stimuli. His speech was spontaneous, relevant, and coherent, but was of low volume and rate and required prompting during the interview. And we also observed pausities in his speech, but there were no features of any formal thought disorder. His mood was subjectively low, objectively depressed. It was less reactive, but congruent to his thought content. And he had suicidal ideas, but no any active plans. He had ongoing depressive cognitions with feelings of hopelessness, worthlessness, and guilt, along with hypochondriacal delusions, but there were no any nihilistic delusions or delusions of passivity. Mr. D was experiencing a commanding form of auditory hallucinations with voices commanding him to self-immolate, along with voices of Gotabaya Rajapaksa instructing him, as well as two unknown male voices discussing about him, which were condemnatory and derogatory in nature. His cognitions, he was oriented in time, place, and person. His attention and concentration, which was tested via the days of the week backwards, was 5 out of 5. His short-term memory tested via the 5-item registration and recall. Registration was 5 out of 5, and the recall was 4 out of 5. And his long-term memory was intact, and he had a good insight. If I were to comment on his physical examination, there was no any major abnormalities. He was alert, afebrile, not pale, and there were no any visible injuries. His lungs were clear, vesicular breathing, and his blood pressure was of 120 by 70 millimeters of mercury with a pulse rate of 88 beats per minute. Abdomen was soft, non-tender, and bowel sounds being present, and neurological examination was normal. We had done all his basic investigations on admission, and I would just like to put up the investigation which had changes. So in his full blood count, as we can see on day 3, he had low platelet counts along with a low neutrophil count as well as hematocrits. And repeated counts on day 4 and day 5 showed further dropping of platelets as well as his hematocrit levels. Therefore, Mr. D was showing persistent thrombocytopenia, and resident physician referral was done, and we were advised to go ahead with doing a dengue NS1 antigen. And his dengue NS1 came out as positive, and the patient was transferred to the dengue high deficiency unit, dependency unit, on day 5 of his admission. I would like to now discuss his stay during the DHDU as a timeline. So he was admitted to the DHDU on his 5th day of admission to the mental health ward. And on day 2 at the DHDU, it was observed that Mr. D became restless and agitated. As he progressed, he became confused, and he had found it difficult to maintain attention. The staff had found him to be disoriented to time and place. His symptoms worsened, and during the day, he began to show mild, aimless hyperactivity, with the hyperactivity increasing at night and difficulty falling asleep. He also began to wander around the ward, as well as being irritable, agitated, and he also developed a new form of saccade pathology where he was paranoid towards the staff and would push the nursing staff away, refusing drawing of blood, and he had tried to remove his cannula and IV fluids. I would now like to discuss his mental state examination while at the dengue high dependency unit. So Mr. D was agitated. He was unable to sit still, and he tried to wander away during the interview. His eye contact was fleeting. He was still responding to internal stimuli, and it was difficult to engage with him. His speech, though spontaneous, was irrelevant and incoherent, and it was usually unresponsive to most of the questions asked, and it had fluctuating volume and rate. His mood subjectively was difficult to assess. Objectively, he seemed irritable. He was still having his ongoing depressive cognitions along with his hypochondriacal delusions, and also had newly formed psychopathology where he had persecutory delusions towards the nursing staff. He was still having his auditory hallucinations along with the voices of Gotabaya Rajapaksa and the two unknown male voices. And in regards to his cognitions, he was now disoriented in time and place. His attention and concentration, which we again tested via the days of the week backwards, was now 1 out of 5. And his short-term memory with the 5-item registration and recall, registration was 1 out of 5 and recall 0 out of 5. We went ahead with doing a confusion assessment method, and it came as a positive CAM score. In this regard, he had both A and B. He had acute onset and fluctuating course. Mr. D had an onset within a day of admission to the DHDU. There was also a fluctuating course with changing in severity during the course of the day, worsening at night. He also had difficulties, he had also had inattention, where he had difficulty focusing his attention, which was shown by an attention and concentration of 1 out of 5. And his speech was incoherent and rambling. Also, he had fulfilled the D criteria, where he had, was vigilant and hyper alert. So now we had to come to the conclusion that we had a few differential diagnoses in Mr. D. We're wondering whether this was a hyperactive delirium secondary to dengue infection in a person with mental illness. Considering his age, we also had to think about whether it could be an agitated depression or worsening of his underlying severe depression with psychotic symptoms, or a schizophrenia with a secondary severe depression. The abrupt onset and the fluctuating course are typical and highly suggestive of delirium. And the diagnosis of delirium among psychiatric inpatients may be particularly problematic due to the overlap in symptoms between delirium and psychosis, a more of a diagnostic overshadowing. So as can be seen in this diagram, our patient had ongoing delusions. He had perceptual disturbances, sleep problems, overactivity, and mood lability, along with impaired attention and disorientation. And as this shows, this can all be features of the delirium, as well as a diagnostic overlap with other mental illnesses. But considering that his symptoms were of acute onset this time, and it was of fluctuating course, there was marked inattention and disorientation in him, as well as altered levels of consciousness, and he had a probable underlying cause of dengue fever. He had the overlapping symptoms, which I've marked in white, showing agitation, sleep disturbances, delusions, and hallucinations. But considering all the above, we managed the patient as a severe depression with psychotic symptoms and hyperactive delirium. So now we had to identify the cause and deal with his problem behaviors. We needed to treat the underlying delirium symptoms as well as treating his mental illness. The cause was postulated to be his underlying dengue infection, and it was managed at the dengue high dependence unit, pre-critical monitoring, and we had to deal with his problem behaviors. We used adequate oral sedation. We avoided IM medications in this patient. We had then had to treat his delirium symptoms with oral antipsychotics. We used olanzapine in him, as well as treating his underlying mental illness. He was treated with antidepressants and antipsychotics. And once his delirium settled, Mr. D underwent 6 cycles of ECT. His delirium settled within 5 days as the dengue infection began to settle. And with treatment, his depression improved as well. Thank you. I would like to now invite Dr. Manisha Dalpadada, Madam, consultant psychiatrist, for the continuation of the discussion.
Thank you, Tashreek, for that presentation. Now I would like to just give a brief overview and an explanation regarding why we chose to do delirium for this presentation, as well as I will also try to cover the psychopathology and the underlying new developments with regards to delirium. So this is the overview of my presentation. I will go through the definitions and the classifications of the syndrome. We'll also discuss the epidemiology, the vulnerability factors, especially with regards to the aging population, the neuropathology of delirium, what we actually do know and mostly what we don't know as well, and then very important, how to screen and the management process, and what is the way forward, especially with regards to delirium in the context of Sri Lanka. I have no conflicts of interest. So delirium has been quite an enigma throughout the centuries. So even during the ancient medieval times, delirium has been described by a lot of people. So Celsus was the person who has initially coined the term delirium, which actually means mental disorders during fever or head trauma. And following Celsus, then Hippocrates used about 16 different words to refer to this one symptom or syndrome, which we now call delirium. Okay. And then, so where did this word delirium come from? It actually came from a Latin word called delirare. So it actually means to go out of the furrow, to deviate from a straight line, or in other words, to be crazy, to be deranged, or out of one's wit, to be silly, to rave, etc. So even hearing those words actually if we now I'm going to show you a poem done by Emily Bronte. So even in this poem you can see that the synonyms that I just previously showed you are used even in this poem. Okay, so so even people like historian Procopius, when he was describing the bubonic plague, has actually documented quite clearly regarding the symptoms of delirium, like some victims became violent with insomnia, excitement, shouting, rushing off in flight, which quite resembles this hyperactive form of delirium, while others drifted into coma, forgetting all those familiar to them and seeming to sleep constantly. And they could die from lack of food or water if nobody cared for them. So perhaps resembling the hyperactive delirium. So throughout the centuries, delirium has been there, but the terminology has been quite a mix up. So now, even nowadays, when it comes to delirium, we use the word encephalopathy, acute brain failure, acute confusional state, organic brain syndrome. So we are using a lot of words to describe the same concept. And this actually goes on to hinder the progress of research with regards to delirium. So nowadays there's a consensus that we should either use two words when we are discussing delirium, that is the delirium per se, as well as encephalopathy. So what's the difference between these two? So delirium means the phenology, the clinical state, which is characterized by a combination of features defined by standard diagnostic systems such as the DSM-5. So it's the external appearance that we actually see. Whereas encephalopathy actually means the underlying brain pathology, which is the rapidly developing diffuse process that might manifest as delirium, or in cases of severity, decreased levels of consciousness as coma. So this is the DSM-5 criteria, that you should have disturbances in attention and awareness. It should be acute in onset. And the third criteria, that there should be additional disturbances in cognition. And then the fourth one, that the A and the C criteria don't occur in the context of another illness, as well as that coma is excluded. And then the last one, that there is some sort of an etiological focus for this condition. So going to the prevalence of delirium, so depending on the clinical setting that you're actually going to look for, the prevalence changes. So as we very well know, even in a 2020 meta-analysis, they have found out that medical inpatients, there had been overall delirium prevalence of 23%, but when you move towards the ICU care as well as the mechanically ventilated patients, the prevalence increases. And what about subsyndromal delirium, where you can't really come to the conclusion that it's delirium, but some of the criteria are still present? When you consider subsyndromal delirium, almost two-thirds of adults over 65 years of age who were admitted to an inpatient medical or geriatric service actually had subsyndromal delirium. So why are we discussing delirium today for this presentation? It's because of this quite overlapping diagnostic conundrum that we usually come across when we are dealing with patients who have delirium. So whenever the cognitive deficits are impaired, we are of course thinking of other differentials, like this patient is having Alzheimer's dementia, perhaps vascular dementia or Lewy body dementia. When the emotional or the mood lability or symptoms like that are prominent, we are thinking of mood disorders. When the anxiety symptoms are prominent, whether there's a comorbid anxiety disorder is there. When the psychosis is prominent, especially the persecutory delusions, illusions, hallucinations are there. In the context of delirium, we of course need to think about whether there's an underlying psychiatric illness that we are missing, like schizophrenia and mania. I also want to touch upon neuroleptic malignant syndrome and malignant catatonia, which I will not be discussing today. But again, their presentations are very similar to sometimes delirium and can be quite difficult to differ from each other in the clinical setup. So how do we differ delirium, dementia, and psychosis? Sometimes we can differ if we look at the onset. So if the onset had been very rapid, then it's quite likely that it's probably due to delirium. Whereas in dementia and psychosis, it usually progresses over time. If we look at the pattern, delirium, of course, fluctuates along the day. And yes, dementia can actually be either stable or it can fluctuate in the clinical pattern, whereas psychosis usually does not fluctuate, unless we are, of course, dealing with forms like acute and transient psychotic disorders. Orientation, of course, is impaired in delirium, whereas it might not be impaired in dementia and not in psychosis. Attention, again, disordered in delirium, and most of the time it's intact in dementia and psychosis. Cognition, well, cognition, as you very well know, in delirium, it's severely disordered. But there are several cognitive domains that do get impaired if you're having dementia, as well as if you're having a psychotic illness, a long-standing psychotic illness. So in those illnesses, the cognition domains are selectively impaired. When you look at the speech component in the mental state examination, in delirious patients, sometimes it's incoherent. Whereas in demented patients, usually it's not. And even in psychosis, it depends on the underlying psychiatric illness. If it's mania, it can be rapid or pressured. And if it's schizophrenia, there can be formal thought disorder. Why are we worried about the aging population? Well, they already have certain vulnerability factors that may predispose them to develop delirium, even from a very minute medical illness. For example, if they have advancing age, that itself is said to be a vulnerability factor. If they are on a concurrent, a lot of medications, if they have a lot of comorbidities, if they have depression, if they have dementia, all of these things can be vulnerability factors for them to develop delirium. So when we try to understand the pathogenesis of delirium, we try to go through the degenerating brain vulnerability. What are the implications of that? So nowadays what they have found is there is definitely an interaction between this underlying predisposition and then with a superimposed acute stressor, which is the key to delirium pathophysiology. And prior cognitive impairment is a progressive risk factor. As baseline cognition decreases, delirium risk also increases in a linear fashion. So what are the major mechanisms in delirium pathophysiology? At this stage, I must say, what we do know is very little. And so what they postulate is that this was actually taken from a review article done by Nature. So these are the major mechanisms that they have thought of. First, whether there's some sort of imbalance in the brain energy metabolism that could be leading to this. Secondarily, inflammation And thirdly, whether there's impaired network connectivity. So if you look at this diagram, whenever there's brain energy metabolism getting impaired, on the left-hand side, you can see a normal neuron. On the right-hand side, you can see the astrocytes. And so they are getting their glucose and oxygen and through the blood vessels. So whenever these things get impaired, they say it could predispose to the development of delirium. And this is a very graphic kind of a overview of what's actually happening in the brain when you're having delirium. So instead of trying to localize one factor as to why a patient develops delirium, we should always think of multitude of factors that could be contributing to this underlying disorder. So it could be that the microglia have already been primed, as well as the astrocytes, and that their activity is actually leading to a lot of damage in the brain, as well as vascular factors and other factors like drugs and other triggers, which are sort of worsening delirium. So ultimately, it leads to a breakdown of the network connectivity, and which manifests in the psychopathology or the symptom manifestation that I discussed earlier. So now we come on to the most important part of this presentation. How do we screen? Are there assessment tools? And what is the way forward? So what are the indications for screening for delirium? So it can be done in different settings. You can do it as an episodic one at a first presentation. You can do it when you actually suspect delirium. You can do it to monitor regularly for new onset delirium. You can do it as a bedside test for ultra brief screening, or we can do it even for research purposes where you can go for a very detailed phenomenological or neuropsychiatry assessment, or we can use certain scales to measure severity of the delirium. So I will just run through the most important ones. In the non-ICU settings, we use the confusion assessment method. So there are four components there, A, B, and C, and D. So A is acute onset and fluctuating course. B is inattention, with C disorganized thinking, and D as level of consciousness. So even in our patient, A and B was impaired, as well as C and D. So ideally, when you're carrying out the confusion assessment method, it should be done based on a cognitive assessment prior to putting up the algorithm, and then it should be followed up by an interview. And if A plus B is there, along with either C or D, then you can come to a conclusion that this patient is having delirium, but this should be mostly a clinical diagnosis as well. And this is one of the most used research tools. There are other tests like 4-ACE tests, which are very frequently used in non-ICU settings, which are easy to use as well. So it has a sensitivity and specificity of 88%, and sometimes they say it has a higher sensitivity and a similar specificity to CAM. So screening for new onset deliriums, these are tools which even the nurses can use at the bedside when they are administering drugs. So I will not go in depth into them. And these are the tools which are being used currently even in our setup in the ICU. So this is the CAM ICU for critically ill or patients on mechanical ventilation. So it can be used either once or even more than once. But the difference from the CAM is it has an inbuilt cognitive test for attention as well as disorganized thinking. And there are other methods like the intensive care delirium screening checklist. And both of these tools are actually recommended by certain guidelines. This is a very short overview of what I have just presented. So depending on the setting, you can use screening tools. So culturally validated screening tools are scarce in our country. So that might be the reason why research is being hindered with regards to this area. Now, with regards to management, nowadays, instead of just focusing on non-pharmacological and pharmacological management of delirium, we want to focus upon this multi-domain approach of delirium, where the family is also taken into consideration, the patient is also taken into consideration, not only treating the etiology and the other factors. So you have to address the multiple contributing factors for delirium, as well as you have to consider what are the current risks because of the delirium, as well as what are the future risks because of delirium. And then correct the physiological imbalances as well as treat the symptoms of delirium, including distress. So what is the place of antipsychotic agents in delirium? Now, this is a very controversial kind of a topic because different studies give different observations. So the 2018 Cochrane Review of Antipsychotic Agents, especially in a non-ICU setting, they say they have no effect on the severity or the symptom resolution or even the mortality of patients who have delirium. And in the 2019 review of 19 studies, again, what they have observed is that antipsychotics seems to be having no effect on the duration, the severity, or the length of stay. And in the setting of ICU, feasibility studies in mechanically ventilated patients, again, they have found no difference in outcome with regards to haloperidol, ziprasidone, and placebo. And this MIND USA large antipsychotic drug trial for treatment during the ICU setting have again found no difference in the primary or the secondary outcomes among patients who are on haloperidol, ziprasidone, and placebo. And again, similar findings for melatonin, remeltion, as well as cholinesterase inhibitors. So what is the recommendation? So there is only a very limited role for drugs in the case of delirium, and that should be only if there's very intractable kind of distress in patients, and then only should you be considering giving antipsychotics. And you should definitely not be giving medications that will worsen the delirium, for example, benzodiazepines. So earlier also I spoke about the outcome, that even in the management you need to think about the outcome of delirium. So in the short term it can lead to falls, aspiration, pneumonias, distress, short term mortality, and in the long term what they have found is an episode of delirium can lead to persistent cognitive dysfunction as well as functional disability, depression, anxiety, PTSD, and even worsening of the cause of dementia. So the long-term implications are not that good. So what are the future challenges for us in Sri Lanka? So this is a grossly underdiagnosed and undetected condition, with fewer than half of cases being detected. And there is a general lack of training at all levels, even at the level of medical students sometimes, with regards to delirium. And there is this perception that delirium is not really owned by certain specialties or group of practitioners. So delirium should be sort of managed by the other part specialty, not us, etc. So that can hinder the management process. And use of imprecise alternate terms also hinders research. And lack of perception that delirium is important is crucial. And it's a challenge. And failure of pharmacological treatment, is it due to the heterogeneous nature of delirium that was studied, is a query. And the neuropathologic cascade, like I discussed before, it's really poorly understood. But if we did know a lot more, then probably we could stop the long-term cognitive deficits that happens because of delirium by giving medications for these plausible inflammatory, metabolic, or neurochemical targets. And challenges of implementation is also considerable, especially in regards to our context. So thank you. These are my references.
Yes, no, we have. Thank you very much, Dr. K.P. Manisha Dalpatadu, for that excellent presentation and a detailed presentation and a review on delirium. Now it would be Dr. K.A.S.D. Nanakara, Senior Registrar in Psychiatry, Colombo South Teaching Hospital, to make her presentation.
Thank you very much, dear madam. Now we are reaching the final component of today's session, and I'll be discussing few MCQs based on what we have discussed so far. So moving on to the first MCQ, you all can see true or false regarding the clinical features of delirium. A, typically there is a slow and gradual onset of symptoms, may present with symptoms that mimic schizophrenia. Reduced alertness is one of the cardinal features. There is altered sleep-wake cycle. Majority of delirious patients become withdrawn, isolative, and poorly motivated. So when it comes to delirium, the several classifications, even the DSM-5 and ICD-10 have described that there are deficiencies or alterations in cognitive functions, as well as wider changes in the behavioral activities as well. So the DSM-5 is a commonly used classification at present. So according to DSM-5, it states that there's disturbance in attention and awareness, and that the syndrome evolves over a short period of time. Usually it lasts to a few days of time, but there can be exception, which I'll be discussing later, and additional disturbances in cognition. Apart from the attention and awareness, there can be changes in memory, orientation, visual spatial ability, and perceptual disturbances as well. When we discuss about the disturbance in attention, the patients with delirium, they are having difficulty directing their attention to one aspect, and also they can't focus their attention from one aspect to the other. And also there's difficulty in sustaining the attention, and also they can't shift their attention as the other people. So what happens is, these people end up with perseveration and also sometimes distractibility as well. Because when we ask a question, they give the answer, but in the subsequent questions, sometimes they keep on perseverating the same answer, because even though we move on with the questions, these people cannot shift their attention. So they keep on repeating the same answer that they gave in the previous question. So with regard to the disturbances in awareness, in the initial stage of the delirium, they become disoriented in the time. They don't know what is the time, what's the date, what's the year. But with progressive severity of the disease, then they become disoriented in place. And at last, even they can't identify the familiar people as well, where they become disoriented in person as well. So when it comes to the disturbances in the other behaviors, one main characteristic is there are disturbances of sleep-wake cycle or the circadian rhythms. They manifest as there can be insomnia, and also these people sometimes they can have complete loss of sleep, even which can continue for days, and also reversal of sleep-wake cycle as well. So what happens is during the daytime, they are much drowsy and they are very slow, but towards the evening, these people become very disturbed and also very agitated, where there's nocturnal worsening of these symptoms. And also they frequently experience these nightmares, and when they get up, they become very distracted and also disturbed as well following this. So in a summary, the clinical presentation of a delirious patient, yes, it is rapid in onset over a few hours or days, and the symptom profile is highly variable. During a course of day, these symptoms can vary. In the morning when we go and see the patient, they might appear very slow, very apathetic, and they are very withdrawn. But in the evening, we get to know this patient has become very disturbed and very agitated in the ward. So that's because there's fluctuation of symptoms during a course of day. And the other important thing is, this delirium can present as different neuropsychiatric manifestations, like some people present with difficulty in no sleep or reduced sleep, and their speech is very pressured, and increased activity, increased agitated. So they mimic like a manic episode. And most of the patients, especially the old age group, they come as much withdrawn and their activity level is low and they are not communicating and they are not interacting with others and their speech is less, which more or less it's like a depressive episode. And also some people can have prominent anxiety symptoms which resembles anxiety disorder. And something very important, even in our patient that we discussed earlier, people can present with schizophrenia-like symptoms. They have hallucinations, delusions, and which is commonly the paranoid themes. And also because of muddled thinking and also reduced attention, these people can have thought disorganization as well. But this has to be compared to with their baseline level. And also these symptoms are quite transient, which is differed from the schizophrenia itself. And the hallucinations, they have mainly the visual hallucination, but they also can get hallucinations like auditory hallucination, tactile hallucinations, but commonly they get the visual hallucinations. So these are the answers for the first question. Slow and gradual onset of symptoms, false because it's acute in onset. May present with symptoms that mimic schizophrenia, yes, true. Reduced alertness is one of the cardinal features. Yes, they have reduced attention, so they are not alert. And altered sleep-wake cycle, true. Majority of delirious patients become withdrawn, isolative, and poorly motivated, true. Moving on to the second question, true or false regarding different types of delirium. Commonly classified based on the level of psychomotor activity, hyperactive delirium is the commonest type. Hypoactive delirium is commonly seen among elderly population. Hyperactive delirium has a poor outcome. Hypoactive delirium can resemble a depression. Delirium can be classified based on several factors. One is based on the psychomotor activity, and also it can be classified depending on the etiology and other factors and so on. But this is the commonest classification that's been used. So there are three main types, hypoactive type, hyperactive type, and the mixed type. Y'all can see that the hypoactive type accounts for half of the delirium presentation. It's around 50%, and they present like withdrawn behavior, apathy, and the slowed movements, and retarded behavior, and reduced speech, which mimics a depressive episode. And also the causes associated with hypoactive delirium are mainly the metabolic causes like uremia, hypercalcemia, and also end organ failures like hepatic failure, renal failure. These people also can present with hypoactive picture. And it's very important, this type is commonly seen among the elderly patients. So we tend to miss or we might not diagnose this hypoactive delirium in these patients. So the prognosis is quite poor considered to the hyperactive type, and there's high mortality associated with the hypoactive type. They said the research has shown that around 1 in 3 people who are admitted with hypoactive delirium and has a risk of dying. Coming to the hyperactive type, which is the least common type, and it's account for about 1/5, and they present mainly with these hallucinations, delusions, and also they are very much agitated, and the behavioral disturbances are common, and it is mainly associated with the substance-related causes. It could be substance intoxication, and also substance withdrawal, as if alcohol withdrawal. If we remind a patient who's coming with alcohol withdrawal, they are autonomic instabilities there, they are much agitated, they are restless. So that picture is the hyperactive picture. And the compared to the others, the prognosis is quite good in hyperactive type, because they said sometimes it could be because they are, since they are much disturbed, they are detected early and the appropriate interventions are taken. The mixed type, it's around 1/3, and they can have both hyperactive and hypoactive features, which can fluctuate over the course of the illness. And there are several etiologies and the factors that contribute to mixed type, and the prognosis is poor as in hypoactive type. So the delirium mimics other neuropsychiatric syndromes, especially Alzheimer's dementia and the psychotic disorders and the depression. So it is very important to differentiate this entity. So when it comes to the delirium, the onset is quite acute or abrupt onset is there within hours to days. And Alzheimer's disease, it's quite over the months and years, and it's very gradual onset of symptoms. Psychotic disorders, it could be either acute or slow onset. And depression, it's not within days, it's usually within weeks or months. So the delirium is quite acute. When it comes to the clinical features, the delirium, they have this confusional state of their consciousness is altered. And Alzheimer's disease, they have memory loss, but their it's in a context of intact consciousness, or there is no confusional state. And psychotic disorder and the depression also, it's same to psychotic disorder. They have prominent psychotic symptoms, but still it's in an intact conscious level. Depression, yes, they are having prominent mood symptoms, the low mood, lack of energy, but it's in intact conscious level. The cause of the disease, the delirium is having a fluctuating course, and classically their symptoms worsen towards the night time. We call it sundowning, because in the morning when we see the patient is quite normal and quite, they're resting, but towards the evening they are much agitated and they're having behavioral disturbances. Alzheimer's disease, the cause is quite chronic. There can be differences, but these symptoms occur or deteriorate over a course of months or years. It's not acute when it compared to the baseline. And the psychotic disorders also, it's chronic. There can be exacerbations, but it's not acute. And depression also, it's single or recurrent episode, and it's over weeks or months. Delirium, it normally lasts a few days, but there are instances that we can see delirium even after 6 months of onset of symptoms, which is rare, but still it can happen. And Alzheimer's disease, yes, it's months or years, the duration. Psychotic disorder, it's months to years. And depression, it's weeks to months, depending on the severity. These are the answers. Classified based on level of psychomotor activity, true. Hyperactive delirium is the commonest. False is the hypoactive type, which is the commonest. Hypoactive delirium is commonly seen among elderly population, true. Hyperactive delirium has a poor outcome, false. Hypoactive delirium can resemble a depression. Regarding delirium, aging, frailty, and cognitive impairment are major predisposing factors for delirium. Acute illnesses, psychological distress, and trauma precipitates delirium in vulnerable people. The confusion assessment method or CAMP can be used in non-ICU settings to screen delirium. Delirium screening tools have high sensitivity. There are no bedside tools to screen delirium. So you all can see this multifactorial model for delirium. There are risk factors or the vulnerable factors, and like dementia and multiple comorbidities, they're higher up in the predisposing factors, because in dementia, there's reduced cognitive reserve and it is a vulnerable brain. So even with a minor precipitant, they can develop delirium. So with regard to the precipitants, it could be like significant events or the severe events such as CNS infections, septicemia, and major surgeries, falls and fractures, and there are multiple causes or multiple precipitating factors. But even the otherwise healthy, fit people, they also can develop delirium if the precipitant is very significant or very severe. And all, even in the pediatric group, we can see delirious patients. Here also, we can see the precipitating factors, predisposing factors, and the protective factors. It's always a balance between these two ultimately end up in the delirium. So the screening tools, as we discussed earlier as well, there are several screening tools, nearly 50 screening tools that can be used to detect and also to monitor delirium. And they can be used in different setups. With regard to CAM-based tools. They are validated to acute wards, the old age group, and the HD or the ICU setups. And it can be used to detect delirium and also to monitor the recovery in these patients as well. And the 4A test, which takes around only 2 minutes. And these screening tools are quite sensitive. Specificity also high, and it could be variable, moderate to high, but the sensitivity is quite high. Ultra brief screening tools, which can be used at the bedside during the ward rounds as well. There are simple ones. We can ask the patient to spell a word backward, or the speak test, a simple question for easy evaluation of consciousness, or speed, single question in delirium. In this, we talk to the bystander who knows him or who knows the longitudinal history and who can appreciate some difference in this patient. So what we have to ask is, do you feel that Mr. X has been more confused lately? It is very reliable and it is very accountable answer to identify that there's some acute change. Aging, frailty, and cognitive impairment are major predisposing factors for delirium. True. Acute illnesses, psychological distress, and trauma precipitates delirium in vulnerable people. True. CAMP can be used in non-ICU settings to screen delirium. True. Delirium screening tools have high sensitivity. True. There are no bedside tools to screen delirium. False. True or false regarding delirium in patients with other medical and psychiatric conditions? Psychotropic medication predisposed to delirium. Delirium is an uncommon syndrome in terminal patients. Delirium in patients receiving palliative care are irreversible. Delirium is common among patients with dementia. Delirium can alter the course of an underlying dementia. So delirium and dementia, two entities which goes hand in hand. Dementia, because of reduced cognitive reserve and vulnerable brain, so it is one of the leading risk factors to develop delirium. And delirium may herald the onset of dementia, certain dementias. And when we consider about dementias with Lewy bodies, delirium is one of the co-sign. And they say because Lewy body dementia, they share similar characteristics of delirium. So it's sometimes called the dementia-delirium continuum as well. Delirium can alter the course of dementia. There will be dramatic worsening of trajectory of dementia, and they lead to rapid progression of the disease and high morbidity and mortality when they get repeated delirium episodes in these dementic patients. Delirium in patients with terminal illness is a common syndrome in terminal patients or in palliative care patients. It could be due to several factors because they are in pain, severe pain, and use of frequent opioids and polypharms. They are being prescribed several medications, and also they are prone to much infection. So all these causes can lead to delirious episodes in these patients, so which result in poor quality of life as well as high mortality in these patients. Because when it comes to palliative care, it's all about comforting and quality of life. So it's very important to identify these etiologies and also to promptly act, because these causes or these delirious states can be treated. And if we identify or if we detect them early and if we intervene appropriately, the outcome would be better. Coming to the final question, true or false regarding the management of delirium? Non-pharmacological intervention should be first line in the management of suspected delirium. Antipsychotics can be used in delirious patients with severe agitation, perceptual abnormalities, and behavioral discontrol. Antipsychotics reduce the hospital stay and severity of delirium. Sedatives such as zolpidem, melatonin can be used. Higher doses of benzodiazepine should be prescribed in managing behavioral disturbances. So when it comes to the management of delirium, there's no single specific treatment. It has to be multi-component intervention where the multidisciplinary team get involved and address the problems. And firstly, they have to identify the etiology or the cause for the delirium and have to treat the underlying cause. And then the non-pharmacological management, which is quite important. and it is very it comes as first line treatment as well. Pharmacological management, no single medication with clear evidence at present, and have to be used very cautiously. Non-pharmacological management, we have to tailor-made the management plan according to individual needs and the patient factors, and have to focus on the modifiable risk factors. We can treat the pain and hydrate the patient, and also assure good nutrition levels and early mobilization. All these can improve the disease course. And then to avoid extreme stimulation and to frequent reorientation, all these can lead to better outcome. With regard to pharmacological management, the use of antipsychotic is quite controversial. And there are some evidence for use of haloperidol when the patient is quite agitated and there are behavioral disturbances, but it has to be used in the lowest effective dose for shortest possible period. And we have to revise the medication with resolution of the symptoms and has to be discontinued. And antipsychotics, they do not reduce the severity or the disease course or the hospital stay. It's only to manage the behavioral disturbances during the acute disturbances stages. And we have to take extra caution when we treat the delirium with Lewy bodies, because they are very sensitive to antipsychotics as well. And we have to avoid benzodiazepines, because benzodiazepines can predispose to delirium and also it can worsen the delirium as well. And the hypnotics or the zolpidem melatonin, it can be used to restore sleep, but still there's insufficient evidence to apply it into the mainstream management. And cholinesterase inhibitors, there's no evidence. We have better to try and avoid the drugs which has anticholinergic properties, because it can worsen the delirium episode. So delirium can be identified, prevented, and treated. We always have to suspect it. When there are such symptoms, we have to think whether is this delirium, and to diagnose and to can prevent it or can have to act accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nana and Clara. I think now the all three speakers, Dr. Faus, Dr. Nanayakar, and Dr. Dalpatadu, are available for questions. Maybe that you all three could come up the podium. My question has to be from Dr. Dalpatadu or from Dr. Nanayakar with regard to the treatment. There is no specific treatment. What about hydration? I think answers have to be from there. Maybe that all three could be there actually. What about hydration?
Yes, madam. Thank you for that question. Nowadays we talk about prevention of delirium as well as management of delirium. So a good hydration is definitely indicated because dehydration is one of the causal factors for delirium. So yes, a good hydration as well as looking to the sleep factors, ensuring a good adequate sleep, all these things actually lead on to even prevention of delirium. So somebody in the audience had actually asked about non-pharmacological or pharmacological measures. Are there ways of preventing delirium as well? So there are non-pharmacological measures, pain management, good pain management, good hydration, identifying the risk factors and minimizing them. What about all these comorbidities that the patient is having, and identifying them and managing them adequately? All of these things can be very crucial in the management of delirium. And when it comes to pharmacological management of delirium, there is some amount of evidence for medications like melatonin, gabapentin, but again, these are very they are not very conclusive as evidence. I hope that answered your question, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Is there a specific advice with regard to the amount of light? Should it be sort of dim light that you have to maintain, or is it well lit place?
It should be an adequate lighting where it should not be where it's very well lit, because it can actually lead to worsening of the delirium. So it could be adequate lighting where the patient can sort of identify where the patient is, so that it will be helpful for the orientation.
Are there any protective factors for delirium?
Yes, madam. So there are protective factors. So when if you go through the previous slides that I have showed you, now things like dementia, things like depression, multiple medical comorbidities, all of these things contribute to the development of delirium. So if we can have very good control of these medical comorbidities, if we can have your diabetes, your hypertension, and all of these things under very good control, that can be protective for you to not develop delirium. In other regards, if you can also look into other factors, like if the pain management, if there's a patient who's going through a hip fracture, etc., if you can ensure that there's adequate pain management, if there's adequate correction of imbalances, all of these things can be protective and helpful in prevention of delirium.
Thank you very much. Is there a place for home management? I think it's all right. It's all right.
Thank you for the question. In regards to home management, so delirium is an acute medical emergency. So if delirium has been detected, it's ideally should be treated in a hospital setup and managed as an emergency. So I don't think there's a place for home management in a delirium setting.
All right. Thanks. Thank you very much. Thank you for the answers for the complete comprehensive webinar organized and for making it a reality. The webinar on delirium, review of neuropsychiatric syndromes. I think that was an excellent webinar and presentation. So let me thank all three speakers. You need to wait, I think. Let me thank all three speakers for their contribution, for the effort and collaboration that have been arranged by the Sri Lanka Medical Association along with the Sri Lanka College of Psychiatrists. Keeping with the usual tradition, let me hand them over the usual acknowledgement of the Sri Lanka Medical Association for this presentation. Dr. Powell. So that brings to an end for this monthly clinical meeting organized by the Sri Lanka Medical Association in collaboration with the Sri Lanka College of Psychiatrists. Let me thank all of you for joining with the webinar. Thank you very much and stay safe. Thank you.